something he said, something he said. His words built a wall inside my head. Just one little thing, didn't mean that much to him, but it keeps building and building, building this wall in my head. This wall in my head. Just one tiny thought, it started out so small. The thought made a brick, the bricks made a wall. And the wall keeps me down, and the wall trips me up. And it keeps building and building and building this wall in my head. This wall in my head. And here I stand with my feet stuck to the floor, as I shout down the street, screaming for more. Over the wall, over the wall, I see my future standing tall. Over the wall, over the wall, I can't believe I'd have it all. So I keep on climbing and climbing and climbing this wall in my head, head, head. I'll keep on climbing and climbing and climbing this wall in my head, head, head. This wall in my head, this wall in my head. It was something he said, just one little thing. The thought left a scar, the words left a sting. Those words are the thing that still hold me in, and it keeps building and building and building and building. And don't fall, I'm finding my feet. This used to be fail, but this wall, it's harder to beat when it's the one you help build.
Shut down by a global pandemic. In the Wings is a collection of interviews with writers, composers, and creatives whose work was affected by COVID-19. In this series, we will shine a spotlight on those productions, featuring live performances by West End stars and emerging artists. These are the stories of those shows, Waiting in the Wings. Episode 2, You and I.
Cordelia O'Driscoll, tell us about yourself.
I am a composer and lyricist from Stroud in Gloucestershire, and I'm 24, turned 24 a few weeks ago. I've written a couple of musicals. This show, You and I, is my second show that I've written with my friend Tom, who's written the book. And yeah, I've been working for the last few years, coming out of university really, working with theatre company that we started with our friends called Colavoce Theatre Company. We started with a show called Buried, which is a musical about two serial killers who fall in love And then that.
As serial killers do.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Everyone does. Yeah. And we did that, did it at Edinburgh Fringe for a couple of years, and we took it to New York last summer.
Terrific.
To the New York Musical Festival. And then from then, we just went straight into doing You and I, which is the show we're doing today, at Edinburgh Fringe, and kind of then took it from there, really.
Tell us all about You and I.
Yeah, sure. So You and I is a musical about this young girl called Fran, who is at rock bottom, basically, at the start of the show when we meet her. She suffered loss, and she's really in a bad place. And then a robot turns up at her door.
Whose name is Robert.
Who's called Robert, yeah.
It's a great name for a robot.
It is, it is. Yeah, and it's kind of about their journey together, teaching each other about the world, Fran teaching Robert how to kind of be human, and Robert inadvertently teaching Fran kind of how to rediscover what is good in her life and how to like come out of her shell and stuff. So it's kind of like quite a sweet, fun tale. Yeah.
And what drove you to this subject? What was the impetus?
Well, initially it was Tom's idea to write a show about artificial intelligence. He was really interested by that concept.
And what's Tom's last name?
Williams.
Tom Williams.
Tom Williams, yeah. I think he was just really fascinated by that concept and how the impact it's having on the world and how much more impact it's going to have on the world. But the story really came from both of us kind of sitting down being like, oh, this would be quite interesting. And I mean, it's gone through many different kind of facets. And the one we're at now is kind of developed. It's been more sciencey sometimes, but at the moment, it's probably quite sciencey at the moment, but it's tying together the science and also the human storyline without making it too complicated or too bogged down with information and making it still quite a human story. So that's been quite an interesting challenge.
Mm. And how did Cordelia O'Driscoll get into writing musicals?
Well, kind of as a bit of a joke, really. Like I started.
It is, isn't it? Yeah.
It's a bit silly. But I started, so at university.
Kind of like we lost a dare.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Almost literally. Yeah. Me and Tom were chatting when we were at uni in our final year. And we'd already been doing work with our friends with Colla Voce Theatre Company, putting on other people's shows and kind of cabarets. And then we thought it'd be fun to write a show because we wanted to go to Edinburgh Fringe. And we kind of had a joke about like what would be like the worst musical to ever write, because it would just be in such bad taste, it'd be awful. And like our idea was like, oh, like a musical about like serial killers, like a rom-com, but they kill people. We just thought that was hilariously awful. But then when we thought that we'd quite like to go to the Fringe, we thought, well, we have had this idea, like let's try and write it. And that was literally how it started. And we wrote it and it just went surprisingly well and kind of was a bit of a runaway train.
In the duty of leaves on trees and ocean waves. There's oyster cards and weird middle names. There's old couples that coordinate their clothes. There's dancing fights and disco nights. All those jalapeno cheesy bites. All the silence that falls over the night. I know it's overwhelming when you look at it with fear. The suffering, the pain, the dark is all that you can see. But trust me when I tell you, it's really not that bad. There's beauty in the little things you don't let in your head. So come on, join the living, and I think you'll understand. Existence is
what are some of your musical influences generally and with this show in particular?
So in general, I've always been, before I was writing for theatre, I was a singer-songwriter and have always loved lots of singer-songwriter music. Like I love John Martin and also like other like soul artists like Lauryn Hill, Bonnie Raitt, Joni Mitchell, just lots of those kind of folky and then also soul and just that kind of music I really love. So I think in that sense, like the inspiration is how I have already written songs inspired, like from when I was younger, from like all this kind of music I listened to. Musical theatre wise, I love Stephen Sondheim, I love Jason Robert Brown. I think it's the musical theatre that's driven by, it's less traditional in a sense, I guess. It's less kind of big orchestras, and yeah, I love that as well, but I think my own music definitely does not, is not in that genre of musical theatre. It's kind of more contemporary, like alternative, moving into like a singer-songwritery style music and stuff. The unique selling point of it is it's quite a surreal story in a sense, but it's very human, so it's quite grounded in reality. So I guess that high concept nature of it could be a unique selling point. Also, the way that the music is intertwined with the show, the band is me and my two friends, Ben and Fraser, and we did all the arrangements together live.
What's the instrumentation?
So I play the piano and the guitar, Fraser plays the viola and the guitar, and Ben plays the bass. So we kind of make it all work together in that sense. And that that was a really fun process to get to, mainly because we were very pushed for time and also because I don't tend to write anything down. So it was easier for me to go into rehearsal and just play a song and then we would just work things out together. And that's what became the music of the show. I mean, there is no score and I feel like very bad for the MD of this because he had to transcribe it.
Not even a chord chart, lyrics and a chord.
No, nothing. Like my score for the show is just like my notebook and like the titles of the songs and like the cue line into it, which is kind of silly because if I forget it, then I forget it. But luckily there are three songs now written down thanks to this, which is great. So that part of it has been fun. I think the whole show in that sense is quite fluid and quite exciting. And there's a lot of great chemistry amongst the cast because they know each other really well.
Do you ever find that your songs that you discover your characters and the story through writing the song?
Yeah, definitely. I think I sometimes come up with like phrases or like a title of a song. I think that happened more, I can think of an example with Buried, my first show. I was thinking about the idea that a serial killer would want to be, or a psychopath would want to be normal. And I'd like had the idea, the song is called Something Ordinary, so I kind of would improvise around that idea of like what that means. And that's how I tend to write all songs, is that I kind of will start playing and then start improvising lyrics and melodies at the same time and playing, and then just eventually kind of happening on something. And that's how one of the main themes from You and I appeared, just as an improvisation that I just sang in one go, and I was like, oh, I quite like that. And then that's now one of probably the main theme of the whole show, but it was just kind of random, which I found quite interesting, because it's like maybe if I sat down like half an hour later or another day, I would not have come up with that specific thing.
There's a robot in my room and I don't know what to do. This is a lot to think through. I'll just stand quietly beside it, won't make any sudden moves. There's a robot in my house. Am I supposed to know what that's about? Somebody's gonna jump out. It's a joke, it's just a person in some questionable clothes. What happens now? Do I scream and shout? Do I ring up somebody? Surely anyone will just think I'm crazy. What happens now? What's the why? The how? I guess I could do nothing, just sit in awkward silence, alone in my bedroom, this robot called Robert and me. A robot came in off the street. Can someone say what I'm supposed to think? Things like this don't happen to me. My life's boring, uneventful, not some sci-fi wet dream. And now the robot's next to me. Is there a rule book for this kind of thing? Maybe it's best I do nothing, but I don't do well with spontaneity or anything that's vaguely scary. What happens now? Do I throw it out? Do I take out the battery? Would I be killing it? Does that make me crazy? What happens now? What's the why? The how? I guess I'll just do nothing, just sit in awkward silence, alone in my bedroom, this robot called Robert and me. I don't know what to do, what to say, what's the right way, the wrong way to deal with this madness. What the fuck is happening? I don't know what it is, who it is, how do I begin to picture this, but I guess it's all up to me. I'm sure that's a terrible idea. Now that we're both here, we could just wait and see, alone in silence, Robert and me. This robot called Robert and me. This robot called Robert and me.
Where had you gotten with the show?
Yeah, well, we had dates in the diary for we were going to be doing the show at the Lowry in Manchester. We were part of their artist development program. So we were going to do some R&D there, rehearse it and do a show there. And then we also had a run booked in with the Other Palace studio, and we were going to be doing lots of rehearsal there and doing
shows there
for most of June. Yeah, it's a really lovely theatre, and the team are really great. So we were just prepping for that, really. We were developing the show for that. Yeah, then it was just like, okay, I'm not doing it.
And how are you coping? How are you surviving through these months?
Well, I mean, it's been obviously very strange. Like, when lockdown started, I went home to my family's home in Gloucestershire. Me and my little brother, my mum and dad, and my granny lives next door as well. So we were just kind of this like funny little unit,
A bubble.
A bubble, yeah. And that they've got a garden, which is great, and it's in the country, so you can walk around.
Oh, that's beautiful.
So it was nice. I mean, it was initially very strange, but I think I haven't really stopped working for like years, really, since I finished university, because it's just been like more and more things. So I, like, for the first time, after about a month of feeling like I was losing my mind, I think I kind of managed to learn how to relax, which I haven't really done.
And what are your plans for the future of the show?
So we are, the things that we were supposed to be doing this year have been postponed to next year, so at the same time. So we're still going to the Lowry in Manchester. And
you have commitment on that? They've committed?
Yeah, I think the other Palace, definitely. I think the Manchester one as well. I think the Lowry just have less... If I'm wrong, I apologise if I'm wrong, they might just know less about their season and, sure. and stuff. But the other Palace dates are confirmed and they're still on sale. And that is happening next year, like, you know, COVID willing.
I think you have to plan. I think, and not just theatres and other business. You just got to get out there and have faith that things are going to... And that's true of those of us who are writers and those of us who are actors. You just have to have faith that you'll build it and they will come.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. And are you going to be in the band? Is that the plan?
Yes. Yeah. Which I'm really excited about because it was so much fun in Edinburgh last year. And Ben and Fraser are also going to be doing it. And I think we'll probably expand the arrangements a bit. We wanted to add in a drummer, but I just don't think there's the space in the other Palace studio because we do everything. We're on stage, so there's just it's a bit too much. But it's super exciting. I can't wait to get back to it.
On, keep me dark. I'm hiding in a corner, don't know which way's up. Lights on, but I can't see. My path out of the forest, blocked by dead trees. I'm locked in, no way out. I'm drowning in a cup that I filled myself. Hoping, no praying. The better days have been and gone. Now I let the shadows keep me warm. Maybe I just need new air to breathe. Maybe then I'll be able to see. Cut me open and I'll bleed gold dust. Maybe if I look the other way, there'll be something that'll make me stay. Then maybe have I always been so invisible? Head down, keep in line. Smile like everybody, let them think you're fine. Each day blends to the other. To see, cut me open and I'll bleed gold.
So Cordelia, what kind of advice would you give somebody who's your age, who wants to make the most of their time in this crazy time, but they don't know what to do first?
Well, I mean, I guess depending on what your main discipline is, you just got to do as much of it as possible in the kind of practice sense, whether that's writing as much as you can, or if you're a performer, just kind of practicing. Because I guess when there isn't actually anything going on and no one really knows when it's going to be back to normal, all you can do is just like get better and get as good as you possibly can be for when things do reappear and go back to normal, because then I guess you're at the top of the pile in a sense of all of these people scrambling for normality. It's really tough though. Like it's a very, very unique
treat it
time.
As a forced sabbatical, and that's that's what the sabbatical is meant to be, recharge. And I think that that's a very healthy attitude.
Yeah, I think you just have to use the time as much as you can, and also not be too hard on yourself, because it's an unprecedented, very difficult time for everyone. So just, I guess, find what you find fun about it and really focus on that, and then you'll probably just get way better at it as you go, just by as a byproduct of that. So
And what about the future of theater? What's your crystal ball saying?
Well, I was thinking about this the other day. Like, I think I feel like small scale theater is going to get back on its feet quicker than large scale in a way, because the overheads are lower and there's just less people involved. And if the kind of amount of people is going to be an ongoing issue, then I think there's going to be much more innovation in that world.
Well, I just want to say thank you so much,
Cordelia
O'Driscoll.
Thank you.
Seeing great things from you, and look forward to seeing what comes next.
Thank you. Yeah, me too. Yeah.